This is Steve Downs, the voice of Master Chief, Sierra 117, and you're listening to Podcast Unlocked, the world's number one Xbox podcast. Now, finish this fight. Master Chief, out.
Hello and welcome to Podcast Unlocked, episode 556. It is August 9th, today we are recording. I'm Raina Sanchez, hosting today, filling in for Ryan McCaffrey, who is out sick. But joining us is the same panel you had last week, including me as your host. But joining us also from away, also really quickly, before I say hello to everybody, please note that we may sound a little different. We may look a little different if you're watching, because we're back in the studio. We're starting some studio recording. Welcome in. Joining me in the studio in San Francisco is Stella. Stella, welcome.
Hi.
And then joining us remotely is Taylor Lyles.
Hi.
And Destin LeGarry.
Hey, everybody. Bam.
Welcome. Welcome. Yeah. So
studio looks great.
Yeah. We have like this really cool industrial theme. It's all green. And I was like, dang, I can like dress to this. This is going to be great. So just a production note that if you do notice like, oh, you guys are just like maybe a little delay or something. We're still fine tuning everything, but I think we're pretty good to go. We can see everybody. It's nice. I'm like, oh, I can see everybody even though we're so far away. But now me and Stella are closer. So hopefully when we do get Ryan back, he will join us in the studio. So please look forward to that. And of course, if you do watch, hello. And if you're listening, hello in your ears, but you know, it's a different kind of hello. Just imagine me waving you to you. But yeah, so today on the show, we have plenty of news to go over. And of course, plenty of games to talk about as well. So let's jump right on into it. Our leading story this week is about the Xbox Series S. So one that I don't think a lot of us have actually had a lot of hands-on time with. I know I haven't. No. I've always wanted to see one because I'm kind of jealous of the folks who have a really cool travel kit for their Xbox Series S. I don't think it's really practical for me, also because I just don't go anywhere. But it's always such a cute console, and I think it's just such a perfect gift. But the big news here is that it's getting a performance boost, which is really cool to see the support for the Series S, as this is such a great point of entry for Xbox if you don't have a PC, or if you're just kind of getting into the games ecosystem to begin with. So this was spotted by The Verge. The latest game development kit frees up hundreds of additional megabytes of memory for the Xbox Series S game developers. And quote, this gives developers more control over memory, which can improve graphics performance and memory constraint conditions, Microsoft's game dev team noted in the June game development kit video. While this should help provide a much needed boost to the Xbox Series S, it will take time for developers to optimize games. And of course, there are no promises for the games that are already on the Series S to get any sort of improvements to their overall performance. Either way, though, you know, more memory is really important and, of course, allows the developers to do more with the games on Series S, which I think are already, you know, doing really good. And as we've talked before, not everyone has a 4K TV and not everyone's like going for the latest tech advancements. Like, it's a pretty heavy investment. So for those of us that do have those, if you do have a Series S, you know, that's maybe going to get a little bit more of a power up soon. Taylor, so I'm going to toss to you because you know all of our tech stuff. You know what's going on here. So how big is this news for the Series S?
Well, I mean, personally, in my opinion, I think it's a really good win for the Series S. I know there's always been that topic of conversation and debate of discourse of whether or not the Series S would hold back Series X and S games like down the road just because of the hardware limitations and things like that. So the way I looked at it was, I think this is a big win, especially for people who don't care much about like having 4K gaming and all that other stuff that you can get on the Series X. And they're more attracted to that Series S price point, but they still want to have like, you know, a consistently solid next-gen gaming experience. So I remember Digital Foundry actually pointed out too, where they said that a lot of the issues with that developers were facing had something to do with the memory limitations with the Series S. So hopefully Microsoft, you know, giving them more access to this memory will help better optimize the games for the system. And also, I felt like you kind of singled me out when you said the Series S was like a companion thing that you could travel with. I was like, yes, because that's how I have my, because I have a Series X and I have a Series S, but I have like the X screen accessory. So I have the little travel case with it. And I'm like, wow, it'll be a lot more convenient for me to take this out and I can actually get more out of it. And maybe it'll help free up some of the games that might've been having some slight performance because of memory and not necessarily because, oh, it's just not powerful hardware.
Right. Whenever I think about the power of hardware, I always kind of put them in comparison. And I know this is maybe an unfair comparison, but no, it's fair. The Nintendo Switch, I'm like, okay, is it better than that? Like, Nintendo tries its best. They had different objectives, right? Like, their objective is to develop systems that work with their games. Like, the Joy-Con is a big part of, like, well, we want this sort of different kind of adventure. We want this to be a handheld adventure, but also a home console. Whereas, of course, when we look at Xbox and the objectives that they have for the Series S, it's very different in that it is supposed to be a lower point of entry. And Destin, I know you've talked about this a lot in the past as well.
Yeah, so I'm really happy about these changes. And these changes are a direct result of developer feedback. And I don't think it hurt that Digital Foundry or even IGN with our performance reviews and anybody else who's out there doing these analysis of the Series S compared to its big brother counterparts, the Xbox Series X and even the PlayStation 5 or PlayStation 4, they're noticing that the Series S is having some issues. And like you said in the intro, Miranda, this is going to improve performance for graphics allocation. So it is going to address those issues. Now, it's hundreds of megabytes, so it's small, but sometimes even with just that amount of flexibility given to developers, they can stretch that a long way to improve the performance of this box. We've set it on unlocked. I believe all of us on the panel called it ahead of the launch of the Xbox Series S. It is one of the smartest things Xbox did, and it has paid off in dividends. I go into most stores in my local area here in SoCal, and they usually have a Series S in stock. You see them at Costco. I go into gaming stores and I always am curious, like, what do you have in stock? Oh, we have one Series S, you know, and that's a really easy gateway for people who don't care about 4K, who don't care about having that highest tier console, the Series X. And we have to remember, though, a lot of us care about those things. A lot of people, I'd say like 75% of the market, really don't care. They just want to play next gen games. They want to play the video games. They don't have 4K TVs, you know. So the Series S just really serves a really great demographic.
Yes, Stella, do you have much experience with the Series S?
I don't, and I kind of wish I did, especially with Gamescom coming up, because I'm going to be gone for like a week. And I'm like, okay, if I'm only going to have my Nintendo Switch to play games on, I'm restricted to like Nintendo games, right? So I'm kind of missing out on the Series S experience. Also, there are so many more, like, I know this is more of an aesthetic thing, but there are so many more cool designs for the Series S, especially with the Fall Guys console that just came out. I don't know if you guys saw it, but it's so cute. Like, it's super colorful. It's so pretty. And I'm like, why don't we get those kinds of options? And Destin's, how is that?
This is what they look like, if everybody's wondering on video. This is the Series S. It's great. I forced myself.
It's adorable.
When it came out, I forced myself to play on it, all my games on it for a week. Like, I played Elder Scrolls on here. I played Red Dead on here. I did all the analysis at launch time. It's a great console. And Taylor, I think you can attest to how wonderful it is to bring it on the go, too. Stella,
oh, yeah, absolutely.
Highly recommend.
Yeah, you want to toss it my way for when I go to Gamescom so I can play on it? Yeah, yeah, just send it over, please. Thank you.
They're what, $50? Let's go pick one up.
God, I wish.
Stella's like, hey, wish. No, yeah. I feel like, Stella, it'd be more practical for you to borrow my Xbox Series S because I have the X screen, which is like the portable display that I reviewed. And you know, you just literally, it's all you have to do is just that sucker it, like,
that's awesome.
And bam, both things are powered up. It's a neat little device. It's got some flaws, but overall, like, for what it is aiming to do, I think it's good. I think my takeaway with the X screen was that, you know, for what it costs, it's like $250, so it's like, you know, $50 shy of a Series S. So I was like, when I'm thinking about the main demographic that the Series S is targeting, this isn't necessarily, you know, an accessory every Series S owner needs, but the ones who clearly want this are, as someone like me that likes to travel, I can just bring this with me. Like, yeah, it makes sense for me to buy one then, but not for everybody. But overall, for what it does, I think it does a great job.
There it is. There's the Fall Guys. If you guys are watching, you can see the Fall Guys Series S. It is really cute. And I love that controller too. And I think that's something that Microsoft has really excelled at lately. Of course, these sort of special editions, especially for the Series S, tend to be like a giveaway or a prize.
Yeah.
And I would like to see them do that. Obviously, that's not as important, I think, as performance boosts. Taylor, do you think this performance boost is going to impact any of the accessories in any way?
I don't think it will. It's mostly just going to be like a software thing, but I would like to see more limited edition consoles now. Ooh, wouldn't that be cool if they did like a Starfield one? But I feel like we'll probably get a Series X version of it. I know this is like wishful thinking, but now I'm like trying to think, how could they do it?
Yeah.
Ideas.
Kind of just staying with this too, though. I mean, for a long time, I feel like the company that's done the best exclusive editions of consoles is Nintendo. Which makes sense because those are usually at a lower price point. People kind of treat them as collectibles, specifically for the handheld versions. And now that we have Series S and, like, no, they're at a little lower price point. I mean, it's still really expensive at about $300 USD, depending on the day. I think right now it's going for like $290, which is, I mean, it's like $10 off. But, you know, still, if you can find a good deal on it, like, that's kind of not too bad if you can get a limited edition for a good deal. But I think, in seeing those as a collectible, it's just something that makes it a little extra special, right? Like, I know I went hard on getting the Halo Infinite Xbox Series X. What sort of special editions coming up would you guys want to see, either for the Series S or X? And honestly, I kind of hope they do both. Like, it's just like, just go all in, man. I mean, why not, right? I'm sure it's still a lot of work, but...
The next Elder Scrolls. I want a special edition of the Series S for the next Elder Scrolls in 25 years.
Okay, if we're going that far out, then I want a Fallout. I want a Fallout one. Are you kidding me? A vault-themed Xbox?
Yes.
Yes, please.
Oh. Yeah, I think, honestly, like, Microsoft just done such a fantastic job with the design of a lot of these. Like, I think there's just so many pretty controllers. I've never been more tempted to buy controllers in my life.
I know.
It's a problem. Why are you doing this? But they're all great, so that's the nice part. But I think, too, with the Series S, and seeing them continue the support is really just, again, good, because there is, I think, an install base here. And Dustin, as you're saying, there's just a lot of availability for them.
Yeah. Yeah, the fact that you can go into most stores and find a Series S, if you're still waiting for a next-gen console, then... And you want Xbox, it's not only great as the second console. If you're like a PlayStation main and you want you still want to play the Xbox games, you can pick up a Series S at a reduced price point. Or if you just want something for the kids and they don't really care about all the fancy graphics stuff, you know, it just serves so many great purposes, and its barrier to entry being so low. And we're going to talk about a story about a family plan that might be coming, which just sweetens the pot, so to speak. So, the Series S is just such a smart move.
Yep, and I hope we continue to, of course, see support for this going forward. Before we move on from this, are there any, like, final Series S wishes that you have regarding performance boosts, cosmetics?
Not
I want
wishes.
Taylor's screen.
Oh, yeah, that looks so good. Look at that. That's so cool.
Yeah, I know, it's actually become one of my favorite, like, accessories that I don't need, but I have anyways, and it's nice to have. So
right, so this is the X screen that we're talking about real quick, and if you're watching, you can see that on video. One of the things that I like about this is that it's always a little bit of a risk if you bring a console or something to a hotel, whether or not you can actually access the US, like, the plugins.
Yeah, the HDMI
might be either locked down or somehow disabled. I'm like, how do you do this?
Yeah,
also, how dare you?
Yeah, but see, when you have X screen, you don't have to worry about it. You just look, and it looks like it fits right on the Series S. I think that's, like, the thing that impressed me the most was, like, I could show this to someone, they would easily think, oh, does that come with it? Like, no, it does not, actually.
Yeah, it's pretty cool. Well, we'll see what else is coming up next for Xbox, but real quick, we are going to take a break. Welcome back, everyone. Thanks for joining us from that awkward break. That was mostly awkward because I tossed it weird, but, you know, it's like that. It's like the back in the studio jitters. Like, you're like, wow, it's like I'm home, but I don't know it, but it's different, but I love it. Yeah. Anyway, we are back and we have more to talk about. Next up in the story, we have some news from Activision Blizzard. They announced Call of Duty Next, a live stream event that will include information on Call of Duty Warzone 2, Modern Warfare 2, and Warzone on mobile. And let me just say, it is very weird to keep talking about Modern Warfare 2 like it's returning, because it's like, ah, that was such an important thing to me. But it's back, but it's different, and it's new. So the information on these will also have a Modern Warfare 2 multiplayer reveal, which is very exciting for me, because that's what I always go to Call of Duty for. It's like, okay, can I one-man army it? How's the time to kill? We doing good guns here? What's going on? Where's my RPD? Okay, then they'll also have streamers playing the games live, and also, of course, unannounced information and surprises. The event will follow by two sets of open betas for Modern Warfare 2, so that'll be our chance to jump into the multiplayer mode. The first set will be from September 16th to the 20th, and will be a PlayStation exclusive, unfortunately for us, but The second set will be from September 22nd to the 26th, and will be on all platforms, so it'll be our chance to jump in unless you have an Xbox. And Ryan left a nice little note. I was like, Marina, are you back in this year? And I was indeed put off by multiplayer last year. Last year, I usually try to do a previews for it, and I couldn't do it this year, which I'm very excited to talk to you about, Sala. But I played it, and I was like, can you get me out of this? I don't want to be here anymore, which is unfortunate. And I think it, in hindsight, looking at Vanguard and how it's performed, I think I was not off the mark.
It's a fair call.
Yeah. It's really disappointing to see that, because I think Call of Duty's been held to a high standard, and although every year will be like, it's the same thing, it's bad. And I'm like, okay, it is bad that it is the same thing or similar, but inherently its fundamental systems were usually really solid, which is what we liked about it. But Vanguard was, I think, or it's been a slow crumble, but Vanguard was especially a crumble of that system where it was just like, this ain't doing it. But Stella, can you tell us a little bit more about Modern Warfare 2? I know it's been a bit since we've talked about it, yes. But you know.
Yeah, I got to go to the preview event. I don't know if I can talk about the multiplayer because it was not even alpha, so I can't really talk about that. But I think I can talk about the maps. The maps look great, sounds great. Could be a little bit balancing, but I gave them feedback on that, so that's good. The single player honestly looked really cool. So there are different levels that, like, so with Vanguard, what I didn't like was the fact that it was back to kind of World War whatever, right? And it's like, okay, great, this we've seen this so many times, right? So this being kind of like a new take on the new Modern Warfare story that's going on, it was really cool. Also, they were able to show off, like, I know they focused on the water a lot. They're like, yeah, we have new water graphics, we have new water tech, and it's actually very impressive because you're going to be able to like swim underwater, and the depth is going to change how enemies can see you, and that's also going to be applied to multiplayer, which is really cool. Also, it's really cute because there are these decoys that I think I've already mentioned, but like they're like the inflatable decoys, right? But like if you put them in water, it'll look like they're swimming.
Just get a little pool boy. I love it.
It's so cute. I think I've definitely gotten bamboozled because they look very realistic. So they do a really good job of that. But yeah, the fact that even the story looks really interesting, and there's that one famous water level on the ship where they showed like you have to move with the cargo containers that are moving to stay in cover. It's really cool and innovative. And it's definitely more exciting to me than the setting of Vanguard, which I know a lot of people worked really hard on that game, but it just did not capture me because I feel like it's a concept that's been done so many times over. But the fact that Modern Warfare 2 is incorporating so many new elements, especially like water and water gunplay and everything, it's really cool. So I'm really excited to play the beta, which I hope, I see that streamers are going to play the games live. Destin, does that mean I get to play the game live for us on IGN?
Sure.
Okay,
yay, cool, I'll do it. Yes, approved. Yeah. You've heard it here first. Stella will be playing the beta.
Awesome.
Yeah, I'm pretty excited for this just because, again, it's comfort food. It's popcorn. Yeah. It's a Marvel movie, basically, is how I say it. It's like, I want to see it once and never again, but I want the full experience. I want, like, the movie theater. Like, I'm going to go out. I'm going to get my Mountain Dew and Doritos.
Yeah.
I do it every single year. I've done it since high school. And then go out, go get it, sit down, buckle in, play for a weekend, and then be done with it. But the hope is that time that I get with it is really exciting and good. And I think that's what I'm looking for here. And I did like the Modern Warfare game. Like I had some, Ryan and I reviewed that one and I had some concerns with it, but generally liked it overall. And I'm hoping that this one delivers as well too. And I think like you were saying with the inflatables, I'm just calling them the inflatables, in the water and such, I really like it when they lean into something that's fun because ultimately like this is a video game and we're here to have fun. It's not like a hardcore military sim. And there are a lot of those on the market that you can go to if that's what you're looking for. And I don't want Call of Duty to be that. Like I want it to have like that really snappy, impressive gunplay that's very reactive and that has like good balance. But at the same time, I want them to have fun. Like I want to have fun. I want a Tamagotchi watch again, you know?
I think Call of Duty is coming at a time where a lot of people are feeling kind of tired of the multiplayer games that are out right now because there's not just a straight like team shooter, like team deathmatch. Like Apex is great, but it's still a battle royale at heart.
Yes.
And it's kind of, and you know, there is the limited time mode control, which is great because it feels like domination, but that's a limited time mode. And a lot of people don't have that one multiplayer game they can just hop into and play a game like around and be like, okay, that's great. I'm going to go do some other stuff, right? Like you can't just disconnect from a battle royale match. Like there's Fortnite, there's also Warzone. And I know a lot of people have been jumping back into the most recent Black Ops just to play multiplayer for Call of Duty, but that's not like the most supportive version. Mm-hmm. So the fact that Modern Warfare 2 is coming out, I think the multiplayer is going to do really well because a lot of people have been wanting something like that. Just jump into really quickly and have some quick matches where you just shoot your gun at people. It's fun.
Yeah, like just, I don't want a 40-minute game. I just want, like, is this going to be 12 minutes? Maybe max? Perfect. That's all I want. Destiny, yeah, go ahead.
Yeah, I feel like Call of Duty gets a lot of hate just because it is an annualized franchise, and there's probably some negativity surrounding the fact that it's Activision Blizzard, right? But I truly think that Call of Duty just nailed the gameplay formula a long time ago, and that's why they've been able to do the same thing for so long, because it's sort of like Madden, where Madden has had its bad entries also, but the people that love this game and want to play it regularly, they're going to keep buying it. And the series has gone on to sell so incredibly well that they're clearly doing something right that I'm sure anybody would want to emulate. So I'm glad that we are seeing improvements in Modern Warfare 2. It does seem like the team who's working on Call of Duty does care about like coming up with new gameplay changes that are positive for the franchise. I feel like it gets a lot of hate, and I think it's just cool to hate on Call of Duty at some point, right? So that's sort of my take on it.
Oh, yeah, absolutely. Taylor, do you have any thoughts on Call of Duty?
Yeah, I mean, I used to like it a lot when, like, I was in high school. So, you know, playing the original Modern Warfare 2 and games like World at War, those are some of my favorites. You know, the recent years, I've kind of fell off on it. Like, I think the last Call of Duty game I picked up was World War 2, and I was pretty disappointed in that, mostly because, again, like as Stella mentioned earlier, you know, with World War II, that setting has just been overdone to death. So it's just like, there's not really, I mean, what else more can you do with that? But, you know, seeing the trailers and just like seeing a lot of the information coming out with this new one, I was like, I might have to pick it up. We'll see.
Yeah. And I think it's hard too, right? Because like with the setting of World War II, I know I've seen some people say in the comments of like, oh, well, it was only two games. Like, why is that such a big deal? It's like, well, the thing is that I think the World War II setting, like, yes, there's a lot to explore there. Like there are many, many untold stories there, I'm sure that we could listen to and that are important. However, it's like, is this the right place to do that? I don't know. Maybe not. Maybe Vanguard didn't do so well, so maybe it's not, but who can say, right? And I think it is refreshing to get that, you know, of course, next in the cycle, which is going back to Modern Warfare. And, you know, generally I'm looking forward to it, and I'm looking forward to this event, and I'm also interested in seeing what's up with Warzone 2. So
even in retrospect, Miranda, not talking about Vanguard, but there was a Call of Duty with the press X to pay respects. Which one was that? You probably know better than I do.
Wait, wasn't that
Advanced Warfare, I want to say.
It was Advanced Warfare,
something like that.
I'm not 100%.
So a lot of people in hindsight have gone back and actually said that Call of Duty is actually really good. So it's sort of interesting because it had such negativity surrounding it. And then in hindsight, people are able to say, yeah, you know what? That actually was a pretty good Call of Duty. It's just, it got so much crap for the things that got wrong. But it's nice to see that people do appreciate it looking back.
But now we have Press X.
Just double checked. It was Advanced Warfare.
Okay, excellent. Yeah, I think it is.
I'm wondering if people are saying that. I was like, are you saying that because it was actually good, or are you just saying that because you liked the meme?
I did not like it.
I do love a good meme opportunity. But I think the thing too, right, is that every Call of Duty is its own flavor, and not everyone likes strawberry and mint. Like some people only like some people like strawberry and some people like mint. But some people like both. Like both ice creams
together.
Yeah.
No, separate. That could be good.
Well, wait,
strawberry? No way.
You shouldn't say mint chocolate chip, because I was like, I do not like mint chocolate.
I don't like mint either, yeah. It's too much like toothpaste to me.
What?
Yeah, it's like if I'm going to eat chocolate in toothpaste, I can just do that myself. I'm not going to eat
mint chocolate
chip ice cream. I'm not vibing.
It's so refreshing. Destin, back me up.
No.
What? Sorry.
Vanilla ice cream is the only ice cream we need. Sorry.
You can put
mint on top of that if you want.
It is a very versatile ice cream.
Yeah.
Only vanilla.
Stracciatella is another good one.
Ryan, come back. Ryan.
Why can't you even eat ice cream?
See, I'll eat pistachio ice cream and pretend that it's mint because it's green.
All right, let's move on.
I'm so disappointed.
Dustin.
It's good.
You guys, do you guys at least like Doritos?
Yes.
Yeah,
of course.
I can't find the spicy ones though. They did like a chili lime or something that I really like. Can't find those anywhere.
Huh.
Those are really good.
I feel so baffled. Okay.
Cool Ranch or nacho, Miranda?
Just nacho. Just give me the nacho.
Nacho cheese for the win. I'm not a big cool.
Well, nacho cool cheese. Ranch. Nacho cheese with the dip is really good.
But dip? That sounds like a lot.
Yeah, so they have, well.
Anyway. Yeah. Anyway.
You're not wrong.
Actually, the next block.
Destin, I'm gonna toss you for something else, though, which you can also tell us about your dip if you'd like. But there's other news in Activision Blizzard and just the general, maybe Microsoft might be acquiring them still. It's still up in the air.
Yeah, so that's still going on. What's happening is all the review boards are looking at, including the FTC, the European Commission. One of those are Brazil, and they have, like, they asked everybody how they feel about this merger, including Ubisoft and WB and all these companies. Most people were like, yeah, it's cool, whatever. Except one, I think we can all guess who, Sony. Sony does not like this deal. And a few of the quotes that I just pulled out for today, and people were surprised we didn't talk about this last week, so we're getting to it now. Some of the quotes were, no rival can overtake Call of Duty. Call of Duty is so popular that it influences the choice of console by users, and their network of loyal users is so ingrained that even if a competitor had budget to develop a similar product, would not be able to rival. And this is translated from Portuguese, I believe. So the translation may be a little wonky. Microsoft also had a statement that basically said the exact opposite of what Sony is saying, and I just found the whole thing sort of comical. So Microsoft is saying, specifically with respect to Activision Blizzard video games, there is nothing unique about the video game developed and published by Activision Blizzard that is a must-have for rival PC and console video game distributors that could give rise to a foreclosure concern. That was their response to the New Zealand Commerce Commission from Rock, Paper, Shotgun, and that was published in June. Microsoft's lawyers even clarified that further. Must-have is a legal term of art and not a statement about the value we place on Activision Blizzard's gaming portfolio. We love every one of their games and have enormous admirations and respect for the creative talent behind them. So this whole thing has been sort of like a back and forth. Sony's like, this is really bad, don't let it happen. And Microsoft, nah, it's cool, yo. Cool, we're gonna be all good. And the reality is somewhere here. Call of Duty, of course, very profitable for whoever owns it, right? But the fact that Sony is like, nobody could ever rival Call of Duty, I'm like, don't you own Bungie? Don't you own Destiny 2, the game that has been on the top 10 charts of Steam, like, since it basically hit Steam? So this idea that nobody can even come close to Call of Duty, I think, is a little too far. But in reality, the conversation Sony should be having is about Game Pass and how that might be more challenging for them to compete against, which they did bring up, actually, further into this report. All the other companies, Ubisoft's like, we have Rainbow Six. Yeah, like, Rainbow Six is great. EA is talking about how they have Battlefield and everything. So it's just sort of an interesting story that we didn't talk about last week that I wanted to bring up this week.
Yeah, I didn't see this last week. Maybe it was just flew over somewhere else in the radar. Thank you for bringing it up, because I think it is important to look at how they're positioning this. And I think, if anything, it's just comical and how Microsoft was like, no, they're whatever.
It's cool, yo.
They're just fine. Like, no, they're not must-haves. Like, no, I'm sorry, we love you. Yeah. But it was just really funny. But I think it is an interesting point, right? Because Sony is essentially paying to have its exclusivity in these deals. So, for instance, even with the beta that they announced, like, they're going to have a Sony exclusive first. And we've seen this as a very long back and forth with, like, who has the Battlefield exclusive? Who has the Call of Duty exclusive? What kind of limited time exclusive is there? And for Sony we've talked about this before, too. It's like, with Sony not getting this access potentially, you know, that could be hard for them. So it does make sense that they're making this argument. And I think, exactly, Dustin, it's not to be like a console war thing. This is just a business thing, right?
Yeah, and also Microsoft has said Call of Duty is staying multi-platform. They're not going to take it away from Sony players. Sony can still charge $70 for Call of Duty, and, you know, Xbox is likely, I would guess, because it's a first-party game, going to put it on Game Pass. And that's truly where Sony has the best business angle to try and block this deal, right? They've argued that Game Pass, if they were to do something like Game Pass, it would reduce the quality of their games, and that there's no way that they could do it. But then fiscally, they're posting record-breaking profit.
Right.
Even with the recent decline, both Microsoft and Sony are still posting record-breaking profits in the gaming sector. So this idea that there's nothing that they could do when they just revamped PlayStation Plus, and I really like the new PlayStation Plus systems, especially the extra tier. I think it's a really, really good competitor to what Game Pass is offering. No, they don't have day ones, but games like Returnal are on there. Assassin's Creed Valhalla are on there. And there's some really, really strong titles. So it's going to be a really interesting case to see how it plays out. A lot of analysts still think the Activision Blizzard deal goes through and it doesn't get stopped. But getting to hear the pitches from all these companies behind closed doors is just sort of a peek behind the curtain, so to speak, about how these mega corporations work. And I find it really interesting.
Yeah, absolutely. And of course, we will continue to follow the story as it develops, just because this is an ongoing acquisition and just big question on whether or not it will go through. Of course, we have some more news to talk about, though, and we will talk about that when we come right back. And we are back. Thank you so much for returning and for watching, of course, or listening, wherever you may be. Hope you're having a nice day. We have some more news we want to get into, and this is another thing that kind of came at toward the end of last week. Taylor, we have some testing for a family plan.
Yeah, so Microsoft, they're basically testing out a new feature for Xbox insiders in Colombia and Ireland, where they can share their Game Pass subscription with four other people. So when I was looking at the news post for it that Xbox published, first off, I was a little disappointed that we couldn't try this out in the U.S., but it's okay. I'm only a little bitter. I mean, it would have been nice to just share that with some of my family members that even though the ones I want to share with are all they do is just play Fortnite, but I digress. But so you can share with up to four additional people as part of an Xbox Game Pass Ultimate subscription. I was like, yeah, I'm not surprised that it's just for Ultimate members. That feels like a feature that wouldn't necessarily be just on PC Game Pass or Xbox Game Pass. But what I found really interesting about it was that they didn't necessarily call it a family plan. And I was like, maybe that makes sense because maybe you just want to share this with your friends, or maybe you have chosen family or whatever that thing. But I thought it was interesting that looking at some of the other features that they have in here too, it was saying something about that members with Xbox All Access, they actually aren't able to participate in that preview, which I was like, oh, that's weird. But I'm sure you guys are familiar with it, right? With Xbox All Access?
Yes. Would you mind giving a quick refresher for those of our listeners who don't remember?
A payment plan.
Yes.
Yeah, a payment plan, so to speak, to buy either a Series X, and I believe it's for the Series S as well. But it's basically you buy it, so to speak, but then you pay it off a long-term sort of thing. So that's kind of sucks that that's not available for those that have that. But I guess I can kind of understand why, as because it's a payment plan. They don't necessarily own it. It's you're just paying it off in increments. And it mentioned something about I think there's a conversion or something like that, but they should offer some type of I guess a discount. That would be cool if they did that for people that were invited to, share someone's Game Pass subscription. I think it'd be cool if they're if you want to have your own, we'll give you a discount. I think that would be cool. I think it would definitely boost up the numbers too. I think the idea of having a family plan, I think, is also just good for if you have kids and maybe you don't want to spend a monthly fee for three different times. But I also feel that this is also a good way for people to just trial it and see, do I like this? Maybe I'll get one. And then Microsoft should try to incentivize those people who are, I wouldn't say bumming off, but more so because this is a feature they're piloting. Well, no, because I keep thinking about password sharing and how Netflix is cracking down on that. I was like, these are not the same things. So I was like, well, if they're gonna do that, they should at least offer an option for people who are part of who are invited to share someone's Game Pass Ultimate benefits, allow them to, get a discounted version, at least for a month or something. I know they have the $1 if you're a new member and things like that. But I don't know, I think it'd be interesting to see how the full version of this comes out and whether or not they will allow US insiders to try this out.
Right, absolutely. They have a lot of cool insider programs, and keep an eye on that for new features. Stella, do you have any intention to do the family plan?
Yeah, why not? I mean, I know. So one of my friends just recently got his PC and everything fixed. So he's like, yeah, does anyone have one of those Game Pass codes? And I'm like, maybe.
Bro, it's a dollar.
I know.
Tell your bro it's a dollar.
But yeah, I mean, it's a good option for, like, you know, people just wanting to test it out. Yeah, like, I think mostly it would be used for friends because, like, my family doesn't play games. But, you know, yeah, I think it would just be really fun to, like, have an option because, like, why not let other people benefit from it? Like, it doesn't cost me anything, so it's fine.
Yeah, and I think Taylor made a good point, too, that they're not calling this a family plan, but yeah. We're just calling it colloquially. But I think that's helpful because it's also a nice realization. It's like, hey, not everyone wants to share with their family, except that's probably what I'll do because it's like, oh, my twin sister pays for it. And then my little brother doesn't because he's like, well, I'm just playing League of Legends. I'm like, okay, but what if the plan later, it includes all the League champions.
Yeah.
Like, this will just benefit you. So it makes it easy. And then I can finally get my dad off of PlayStation and say, hey, sorry, dad, you got to play with Game Pass. Like, it's just that kind of thing. It feels like it's almost a sneaky, hey, sorry, you have to get, you get this. And now you have to play Halo with me again. I mean, my dad used to play a lot of Halo, but.
Yeah, this is perfect for him.
Exactly.
Yeah.
So, like, this is just such a good opportunity. I feel like, in a way, Microsoft is making this easier for me to, like, force people to play Xbox stuff. Which, I don't know. It's like, yeah, I'm sure they want to. Yeah, exactly. It's like, oh, well, I got this for you, so now you have to play with me.
Oh, my God. You're guilting them. But, yeah. Like, it's good.
It's my fine. Money, and yeah. I did this for you.
Yeah.
For me. But no. I think it's just a smart move, and I'm glad that they're starting to test it so that we can hopefully get this sooner rather than later. Destin, do you have any quick notes on this before we move on?
I really want the Family Pass to be a thing, or Friends and Family Pass. However they end up marketing it. I think this would be great, especially for people with kids or multiple people in the same household that want to play games on their own profile. Yeah, you can set your one console to home console, but, you know, you probably, like, I want to play Halo. My son, when he's older, he's probably going to want to play something different, you know? So I think this is great, and I hope they keep looking at ways to expand their user base. Like, the All Access program is great. I think you end up paying $10 less or something like that over 2 years. And it's also like you don't need an amazing credit score to be able to utilize that. So allowing more people to play games, I think, is great.
Yeah, absolutely. Speaking of being able to play games, let's talk about a situation where you're going to have to wait longer to play this one. So Marvel's Midnight Suns has been delayed for a second time. So that was yesterday, and it doesn't seem to be a long delay, at least. But now we're once again without a clear release date for the Firaxis tactical RPG. So this is in Take-Two's latest earning results. The publisher revealed that it has moved back the launch of Midnight Suns to ensure that the teams at Firaxis Games and 2K deliver the best possible experience for our fans, they said. It's expected to arrive later this fiscal year, quote-unquote, which means sometime before March 2023. Fiscal year stuff is always fun. It's just like, what about the normal year, though? Can we put in context of this? No. The fiscal year. So at least we have some span for what's coming next year. And unfortunately, I don't have the full list of what's coming next year. But now, as things keep moving out of this fall, next spring is going to be rather busy, it seems like, or next early winter and spring. So this was going to be for PC, PS4, and Xbox Series X and S.
I think that's supposed to be PS5.
Yeah, I'm like, wait a second.
Yeah, I think Ryan wrote it wrong.
Oh, it's okay. It's notes. I didn't double check these. Anyway, well, it's going to be next year. And okay, so there are two different versions of this game. So it's going to be the PC, PS5, Xbox Series X and X. That's an earlier release date. And then the old gen consoles, so PS4, Xbox One, and Switch, which is not an old gen, but it is just kind of lumped in with them, unfortunately, will be later in the year. Or just later. We don't know when. But
I guess you could say it's coming everything under the midnight sun. I'm sorry. Yes.
Okay.
I'm sorry.
You know what, Taylor? I appreciate you. You can. This works for me. This works. So the second delay was due to a search for quality and a great number. And they have a great deal of confidence in what they have with Midnight Sun. So we'll see. And they don't seem too concerned. How are you guys feeling generally about all these delays, especially for this? And Destin, I think I'm going to toss it to you because I think you were interested in this game.
Yeah, I'm really excited about Marvel Midnight Suns. Their official quote was that this is for quality concerns, right? Mm-hmm. Marvel Midnight Suns is easily the biggest game we've ever made, as you alluded to in the intro. So, like, if it's really big for them, and what's more surprising to me is the fact that they are separating off those old-gen releases. So we're going to get the next-gen release, including PC, So Series X and S, PlayStation 5, and PC, sometime before fiscal year 2023. So I believe that goes until March of 2023.
Yes.
I'm a little surprised it was delayed, because it looks like it's pretty far along. We've gotten a lot of character vignettes and gameplay cutscenes and such. I hope nothing's seriously wrong with it, because I am really excited about this game. Marvel Midnight Suns reminds me of this game, Overpower, I used to play in high school. Mm-hmm. I feel like I've said it like a million times, but Overpower was basically a card game where you would hit your heroes against another set of heroes, and you know, they'd beat each other up. And Braxis, the makers of XCOM, are not known for making bad games, so I'm really stoked to see what their take on a Marvel game with these heroes. I think the big negative reaction is about the card system. There's a lot of good examples of card games out there that, you know, Dan and many other people have probably alluded to. So I think there's a reaction that it's like, oh, this is like a mobile game because it uses a card system, but you can make a great game that utilizes a card system.
Right, absolutely. And still, I feel like we were talking about card systems in games at some point. Maybe it wasn't, but I know there's like Back 4 Blood had a card system, mm-hmm. but how do you feel generally about card systems and... of course, Midnight Sun.
So, I mean, I'm not into tactical RPGs at all, so this is, like, not really up my alley. I will watch the cutscenes just because I'm curious about the story. So it's, like, one of those things where, like, yeah, I'll watch someone else play it, but it's not for me. But I think card systems in games are fine. I mean, Titanfall 1 had that, and it was actually great. Like, they had the burn card system where you could constantly, like, use a special card that would give you, like, the ability to turn into a Spectre, which is one of the robot enemies, for, like, a round, right? Until you die, which is really cool. So I think it, like, keeps gameplay fresh, and especially in a game like this where it revolves around superheroes, I feel like it could be used pretty well. Also, XCOM is like a hailed series, so like I trust Firaxis to utilize the card system really well, because I feel like it can only enhance gameplay and mm-hmm. it keeps it fresh, because like not every card system is, or not every deck that you get can be the same. So yeah, I don't know. I wish I was into tactical RPGs. It doesn't capture my interest.
No, yeah, that totally makes sense. Yeah. And I think, if anything, with this being a Marvel property, I wonder if this will get more folks to try it just because. Yeah. And maybe they'll find out that they like card system games. Who knows? Taylor, do you have any interest in this one?
Me, I'm that person that you were just kind of singling out about, oh, well, it's a Marvel property, so maybe this will be their way of, like, dipping their toes in. Yeah, so I'm, like, on Stella with that front. Like, I'm not really into tactical RPGs, but I do agree that card systems and games, if done right, can actually make a game even better. But, of course, there are some games that have implemented card systems, and they were not that very good. But this is, the fact that it is, like, a Marvel property, I'm just excited to check it out just because of that. And who knows, maybe I'll like a new genre out at the end of the day. We'll see.
Yeah, absolutely. I guess we will see before the end of fiscal 2023 or something. March 2020, fiscal year, March 2023.
Where's our preview for Axis?
Come yeah, on. Come on.
I want to play.
No.
I'm excited for your game.
I'm sure there's other people too.
I'm a huge superhero game nut. Like every superhero game, I at least check it out. So like, it's just like, I love comics growing up. So for me, I'm interested enough to try it out just because of the fact that it has superheroes.
Yeah. At least we'll still have Gotham Knights later this year.
True. That's good. Excited for that one too.
Yeah.
Yeah. And so we do have a little bit more news to talk about, and we will end our show with that. But before we can, I tossed one more break. We'll be right back. And we are back to talk about the final bit of news that we have for this week. Since Ryan is out, we won't be doing trivia just because I want to participate. Like, we have the questions and now I can think on it for like a week, but I'm not looking.
I think I knew the answer too, so.
Wait, did I know this one? I don't know this one. But yeah, sorry, Taylor. No one gets to go on the board this year. Okay.
I had a guess.
Okay.
We could do it and then just Google it, and then we could do a different one.
I don't even need to look it up. I already know what it is.
Like, oh, bam.
Wow.
99.9% confident.
Taylor can go first.
Kidding, Taylor, can you tell us the answer so I can all just welcome on the board this week?
No, hey, you're already winning.
I want to really win more. I like doing trivia. Like I do, I start doing trivia nights again. Like at this like local bar that I go to. Oh. It's really fun. I got third place last week, so I'm a little bitter about that. But I'm a comeback kid, so I'll get first place next time.
You can do it. I believe in you. I believe in me too to win. Sorry, everyone else. Anyway.
Oh my goodness.
I feel like I should get a point every time I have to host as a fill-in, but you know, that's fine.
That's gonna be a lot.
Anyway, let's get back to some news because I know that's what you guys are here for, probably. I hope. I don't know. I don't know why you're here, but I'm glad you are here. So we do have a few other stories that we can touch on real quick. I think we're going to go ahead and leave with Evo, which just happened this past weekend. Of course, that's really big for the fighting game community. Happens every year.
The Street Fighter Grand Final was so good. Mm-hmm. It was so, so good. Our own Mitchell got to go. Mitchell Saltzman
competed. Yeah, that's so cool. Oh. Every time someone I know who goes, I'm just like, you're number one in my heart. You win. That's the battle for us, I think.
You're a great trier.
Absolutely. From there, we had a few different like releases and teases, but SNK announced a development of a new Fatal Fury game. So this is on stage, of course, this past weekend, EVO 2022. So this was a new entry in the long dormant Fatal Fury series, and now it is in development. The series has been in development the franchise has been around since 1999 and was paired only with a short teaser and a single piece of artwork, which is, you know, that's okay. I think it's pretty cool to see them bring these things back. And of course, as this is a big fighting game focused event, like it's nice to see those announcements. And I know there was a lot of excitement also for Multiverses there. I know a few of us have been playing that. Dustin, I think you've been playing
Multiverse. No, that's Ronnie, I believe.
Okay.
There's also, I think there was Tekken 8. Harada-san did that in a really, really cool way.
So
basically
funny.
They showed the end, like an ending scene from one of the super old games, and then like a smirk from one of the main characters, and that was really, really neat. I have no idea what this B-roll is.
I think this is probably for Fatal Fury. This was a specific note from Ryan, which I'm just kind of reading his notes because he didn't get to be here to talk about this. I know he was like kind of excited to talk about some stuff. The old franchises never die, which is not untrue, except for the ones that we love. Which not that people don't love this, but there are certain ones that we personally love that we would love to see to come back. Of course, there's some stuff that gets killed off, and Ryan was mentioning Mirror's Edge. I think he still wants that to come back. And
I would love that. Yeah,
I would like Dead Rising to come back.
Oh, Dead Rising.
Yeah, I love Dead Rising. Dead Rising was cool.
When was the last title released?
What was it? 2016, 2014.
Okay, so it's been a while. Okay.
It's been a hot minute, yeah.
Yeah. What I come from this, my big takeaway is that we need to have gaming events for the things we love most, and if we have those, we can will into existence the things we love to come back. That's what it is. That's what Evo is. It's a big fighting game tournament. It's a big pinnacle moment, and if people are like, yeah, people care about this, I'm like, yeah, okay, we'll now bring back the things that I love. It's like a summoning circle.
This year it was Fatal Fury. Next year it's Injustice 3, the thing I want.
Okay.
I love that.
Yeah, there it is. Yeah, this is such a fun way to tease the Tekken
it's
thing.
It's so good.
Yeah, really, really love that.
This just reminds me of... Oh, I'm sorry.
And then the smile at the end. Possibly just goes... Yeah.
if you guys have...
Yeah, that's right.
I don't care if you like Tekken. I don't... care if you dislike Tekken, whatever your feelings may be, watch this trailer. It's so really funny. Also, it reminds me of Smash because there was an allusion to this in Smash, which I'm like, wow,
that's right. Oh my god, yeah.
Yeah, anyway, game history is really good, folks.
Kudos to the production team at Evo. That was a really, really gorgeous looking show and event. Mm-hmm. Lots of people were there, and it was kind of cool to see all that, but yeah, the camera work was really good, and most of the fights really good. There were some tech issues, like there always is with big ones. The pools for Mortal Kombat went offline, unfortunately, so I wasn't able to watch all those. But great, great show Evo is.
Yeah, absolutely. And be sure, of course, to check out that trailer and the trailer
I said it that way.
You know, I've made so many mistakes today. I'm like, I don't know what's happening. You know, I just got pulled into this, and we're here doing our best, and I think we're having a
great
good time.
Great show, Evo is.
Yeah. It's all the green, you know. You're just like invoking Yoda a little bit.
Yeah, Yoda.
It's fine. I'm just still crying over Mint. Anyway, final story.
No one likes Mint.
Touch on today is that 6 years after Beyond Good and Evil 2 was announced, it's hired a lead writer, which is like
Yeah. Great. Glad they're going to look at the script.
I don't pretend to know all the work that goes into game development. I know it's a very hard, difficult production process, but man, has this gone through some work. I remember this being announced. I remember Alana Pierce being so excited. I was so happy for her. I was like, man, this is so cool. And I remember the fallout about the art thing, and then there's just been radio silence. And now we at least have this from a tweet yesterday. So on Monday in August, Sarah Arellano, excuse me, I think is how you pronounce it, announced that she's joining the game as the lead writer. Previously worked on a narrative design for Blizzard in World of Warcraft and at Volition, the studio responsible for Saints Row. So that's really good, but of course it's been a bit, and I don't really know their history, but this is really funny because Ryan asked us, what's going to come out first, this or Dead Island 2?
Yeah.
Oh. I don't know, the competition's pretty fierce if those are the two options.
Yeah, and also, like, looking at this trailer for Beyond Good and Evil 2, I haven't played the first, but it looks really cool. Like, we've been watching this reveal for forever. It's just a big cinematic and, like, this sprawling world. It's really a beautiful city. And I'm just hoping that this time that they've had to figure out will allow them to, like, develop that in a really neat way. There's nothing more exciting to me than seeing a city filled with just rooms and shops and things that I can go into and explore and get, like, an identity of this place. And the worst part of that is when you can't actually go into anywhere and you just see it's all set dressing, right? And so I'm hoping that this time that they've had will really help them, like, develop what this world is and get, like, allow us to go explore it to its fullest. So, of course, we know COVID has provided a lot of challenges for game development and plenty of delays, as we already talked about today as well. So hopefully there's something out. But real quick around the room, what do you think is coming out first? This or Dead Island 2? Stella, go.
I have no idea. I don't lean towards either. But if they let's say I'm gonna be hopeful. Beyond Good and Evil 2, let's say.
Okay. Destin?
I think Beyond Good and Evil 2. I don't know what happened with this, because the reveal in 2017 was really cool looking. Like, look at these cutscenes that we're looking at right now. They clearly took a lot of time and effort to develop this. Something went crazy at the studio. Like, major reset or something, but I don't really understand the reasoning or logic. I'm glad they have a lead writer. I definitely think that this comes out first, because I think Dead Island 2 is done, like, it's never happening. But I'm also worried about Beyond Good and Evil 2 to have, it's been what, 5 years? 17, 18, 19. Yeah, 5 years since the reveal trailer. Like, something bad happened.
Who can say? Taylor?
Probably have to say Beyond Good and Evil 2. I mean, just because, like, I mean, look, as much as I want to say Dead Island 2, I agree with this, and I think it is on a dead island right now. But I mean, because, like, with the Beyond Good and Evil 2 news, like, it sounds like we're not getting this anytime soon if they just hire a writer. But the fact that we have some type of update is better than radio silence that we have got from Deep Silver, who every now and then they're like, no, it's still happening. I'm like, okay, that's great, but that feels a little empty to me now at this point, because there's nothing else you're showing. So I go back and watch the trailer, because it's still, like, because the announcement trailer for Dead Island 2 still makes me laugh, because I think it's funny.
I'm going to say Dead Island 2. I believe it will rise from the dead.
You're like, just saying it to save the
I believe
one.
In mint. You don't... I believe in green things. I will stand alone on my own island, and I'll have all the mint ice cream to myself. It'll be great.
I think I played Dead Island 2. I think I still have footage on my computer of that.
Oh, gosh.
That I just won't delete, because I'm like, it does exist. That did happen. I did play it.
It's just another one for the Destin archives. I think that's just that's just your legacy. With that, folks, I think we are running out of time. Real quick, I do want to go around the room to see if you guys have any shout outs or any cool projects you want to talk about before we wrap up. Stella?
Yeah, we were talking about Evo on the Compete Fix today, which should hopefully air in maybe before this. if you check it out on IGN's main YouTube channel, it'll cover all the biggest news from Evo, including the Street Fighter V tournament that was just incredible. I cover IDOM's Legendary Run, so yeah, keep an eye out for that.
Awesome. Taylor, what's up with you?
Ooh, I'm working on some really cool stuff for work, but I can't talk about it right now because I respect embargoes. but keep a close eye on it in like the coming weeks. But I'm really excited to share it once I can buy it, once embargo lifts.
Yep.
Sorry, I can't say much.
Ongoing thing, always. Dustin, how about you?
Yeah, I still have it. I found the clip and I brought it up.
Oh my gosh.
So I'm going to be rewatching my Dead Island capture from like when at whatever year this is from, 2014. Anyway, yeah, we have a, what am I allowed to say? Spider-Man is coming to PC and we have a performance review coming. The review embargo is tomorrow. That'll be done by Michael and I'm very excited for you to view it. No impressions in that statement. Those are all just factual things that are happening and that's what I'm allowed to say.
We are professionals. Okay,
we got it. Are dumb.
All right.
But yeah, excited about that one. And also, what's that thing I always talk about? Cookies. LeGaryBakery.com. Cookies are still going. And I did reduce shipping a little bit. I figured out a thing. I turned on ground shipping for all the US, basically.
Nice.
So should help a little bit.
And, be really good to pair. With some vanilla ice cream. All right. And then for me, I just have a review for a show coming up this week. I don't know what if I can say what it is. I mean, it's not. I don't think most of you are going to care. But I hope you do. Please read it.
And, I care, Miranda.
Oh, thanks. Yeah. Thanks, Taylor. Other than that, I've been playing Wolfenstein 2 on stream, the new Colossus. It's been fantastic. And I love it. I love BJ. Terra Billy. It's my boy. And with that, for Taylor, Dustin, Stella, and Super Producer Ed, I am Miranda Sanchez. Thank you so much for joining us today in this very wild episode. Welcome back to the studio. Welcome back, everyone, to our office. And I hope you guys enjoyed this episode, and we will see you next week. Bye.